Todd Morrison. It's a real privilege to have Todd on the panel. Todd Morrison is the president of the American Deaf Association, MDA. And I love when I get to do research on people and learn more about organizations and people and groups. MDA began in 1880. So we're here celebrating the 50th anniversary, which is wonderful. But we need to honor the generations and leaders that came before us in the field of civil rights. And they are celebrating their 134th anniversary, which I have tremendous, tremendous respect for. MDA, which began in 1880, is committed to improving the lives of the deaf and hard of hearing people. Todd Morrison is also the co-founder of the Deaf Employment and Business Solutions, a company committed to increasing accommodation support services for employers and job seekers. A real pleasure to introduce Todd Morrison. Thank you.
Hello, good morning, or is it afternoon now? I guess you could say it's afternoon. Anyways, I don't even know where to start. I have 5 to 10 minute window. I think I'm going to try to use this as an opportunity to try to stretch my time and make this window as big as possible. MDA is over 100 years old. We are a chapter of the National Group for the Deaf. We are the oldest national group that services the civil rights the Deaf and Hard of Hearing Services here in America. And in this room, I see a variance of people, different race, different religions, ethnic backgrounds, all these different diversified people in this room. And I can tell you that I envy you. The accessibility that you have to communication. You could go anywhere right now, today, and you have people advocating for you right now, today, in this world, and I can't. If I go somewhere, I have to figure out how to make communication accessible for myself. And it's very, very important, that tool. Even with communication, there's misunderstandings that take place, and trusts are broken. And people are fearful of that trust. So you take away the communication, and that's a struggle. And that's like even worse when you don't have the communication, effective communication taking place. It's such a struggle. And we are a successful group of people. And we're pursuing the American dream just as you are. And we advocate for our community and have been for many, many years. Most of the time our advocates are really focused on accessibility and for communication. We have a situation, a divorce case, actually, that has taken place, a husband and a wife who are separated. The wife had to become the interpreter for her husband. No. How do you do that? How can you separate yourself from that? It's things like that are happening that are leading to the broken trust in relationships that are taking place between the hearing communities and the deaf communities. The MPA is really, they're responsible for setting up the division on deaf and hard of hearing, the government division that we now currently have, who is under the Michigan Department of Civil Rights as of last year. And our division has been moved several different times under several different departments. We were under DLEG at one point, under VARA, MRS, and now we're under civil rights. And I can't tell you how much I am pleased that we are finally under the Department of Civil Rights. I can't think of a better department that we should be under that should be advocating for the rights of the deaf community. In case in point, comparatively, we have people who can hear, or who have a hearing loss, rather. And that's a wide spectrum. You know, we have people who are hard of hearing or latent deaf. There are those who are born deaf. And we have about 900,000 people living in the state of Michigan with some sort of hearing loss. And so, comparatively, the blind community, there's about 200,000 people. Annually, the annual budget for the blind is $23 million annually. The deaf community, the Division of Deaf and Hard of Hearing, is about 7 $780,000 annually. That's a lot in our budget to service those people. So the breakdown, the per person budget, the breakdown is $118 for the blind community and 91 cents for the deaf community. 132 years worth of work, and we've only accomplished 91 cents per person. Really? We have a long way to go. And this is an opportunity for me to ask you, how many of you have really worked with deaf people before in the deaf community? Or anybody with a hearing loss? Have you ever had the experience of working with anyone like that? The biggest challenge that we face right now is the court system. Legal services, they refuse to provide interpreters. And we have to tell people, no, we're not going to provide accommodations for you. In the year 2008, Michigan State Supreme Court, SCOA, released a publication saying that all the courts were mandated to provide accommodations. And today, I'm sorry to tell you, that's not happening. As of yesterday, I just had to help a deaf person file a civil rights complaint on behalf of an attorney who refused to provide accommodations for them. So I'm asking you now today, this is a law school, maybe some of you are attorneys here. So lawyers, obviously, you are here to service the people, right? And to service the community. And how can a person determine if a deaf person doesn't deserve equal access, doesn't deserve the support that every other American receives? Why can't we have equal access like everybody else? I don't understand why we don't get the support. I think one reason could be the disabled community and what I would call an ongoing penalty. There's another group of that has disabilities and they have like a one-time fee, for example. If somebody needs a wheelchair ramp, that's like a one-time accessibility. You pay for a ramp and it's done and over with, and everyone has equal access from that point on who is in a wheelchair. There's no other fees included. You know, they have like the different bumps that they can put on the sidewalk for those who cannot see. You know, that's an accessibility, a one-time fee that they pay to set something like that up. Or a hearing loop for a person who can't hear very well is a technology, a piece of technology device that they have to buy as a one-time thing. But unfortunately, you see the interpreters sitting in front of you right now, so there's a fee for their service. And that comes with every deaf person, so that costs money. Our community feels that there should be some kind of tax subsidy system. We shouldn't burden private businesses or any kind of corporations for those costs. The government says you have to accommodate, right? Everywhere you go, with just driving to McDonald's, talking with a police officer, for me, trying to find parking this morning was a struggle because I had to find a way to communicate with somebody who, you know, knows the building and is comfortable enough to sit there and talk with me to let me know where I can park. Our struggle is the same as yours. The only difference is we lack ongoing accessibility to communication. Just recently, we had a deaf interpreter, the Deaf Persons Interpreter Act. It's a law that was passed in 2007. But we didn't have a set of rules to go along with the law to explain the different kind of certifications that would be acceptable to be named a person to be named as a certified interpreter. It took 7 years to develop these rules and have them passed. I'm trying to compare it with all the other groups of people who are out there trying to come up with new rules and the process, the administrative rules and the process that go along with making these laws that pass. It might be 2 or 3 years at the most. 7 years it took for ours to pass. Legislators passed the law in 2007. unanimously, with 100% support. But it took 7 years for the rules part to pass? I don't get it. Our fight is always long, and it's always such a slow process. And it would benefit both of us. If everyone would just accept the fact that disability, disabled people, are people too. We just don't only focus on gender or religion or sexual orientation. It's not just limited to those. There's also people who are disabled. Disability, that's one of the factors. And oftentimes, we always say, fight for the rights, when we have all of these different people that we're fighting for, but unfortunately, disabled people are ones that seem to be left out. People like me, I don't really see myself as a disabled person, I don't. I'll be honest. I have a career. I run a nonprofit organization that employs over 100 people that annually earns $5 million. It's a debt organization. If I were to go to some place in the public and have a career, I wouldn't have that opportunity that I'm afforded here. I would probably be given an entry-level position. Deaf people with professional degrees are underemployed because, they say it's a high level of risk, and people are nervous about putting deaf people in those positions. We have approximately 300 attorneys that are deaf, and they work all over the U.S. And that's not enough. That number is not nearly high enough. I feel like any law school should make a point to be recruiting these people. Get them to join your schools. Disabled people are still an important group of people. I am a white male standing up here telling you what it's like to be a person of color. If I was up here trying to explain to you what it was like to be a person of color, you wouldn't listen to me. You need someone who represents your community, that's within the community, within the government system, within the court system. You need the right representation, and I'm up here representing our community. I'm up here representing our needs and how we can develop a good, healthy working relationship. Again, 91 cents per person for people with a hearing loss. That's the state's allotment of money to service everything from early childhood programs, all the different programs that we have, 91 cents per person. You can't even buy a candy bar for 91 cents nowadays. That's a serious problem. 130 years, we should be way further ahead than where we are.